Good evening and welcome to this episode of Community Crossfire. I am your host, Ken Livingston, the director of Get Delaware Reading with United Way of Delaware, filling in for Xanthia Oliver, third Wilmington City Council, third district council person, Xanthia Oliver, who is away on vacation. Today we'll be joined by some special invited guests. My colleague who is here with me, Ms. Deborah Reeves from United Way of Delaware also, and we'll just be doing a recap of our third annual Winter Wonderland event that took place on December the 16th at the Wilmington Library. Before I get started, I just want to make sure to give Carl and Jamar a special shout out at the Wilmington Library for allowing us to come in to host our event year after year after year. So once again, thank you, Carl and Jamar, for your partnership and your collaboration. So I'm here with some special invited guests from the Wilmington, Delaware chapter of the Lynx Incorporated. I was practicing behind the scenes. So we're here, we're joined with them today, and they were at the event, and they're some of our special sponsors, and we just wanted to bring them on just so they can give us their take on the event, how they enjoyed it, and why they decided to contribute and also volunteer at this event. So I'm going to start with the special guest to my left, and could you please introduce yourself?
Absolutely. My name is Melanie Spate Daniels. I am the financial secretary for the Wilmington, Delaware chapter of the Lynx Incorporated.
And guest number two.
My name is Chanel Griffith. I am the programming chair for the Wilmington, Delaware chapter of the Lynx Incorporated.
And also, Chanel, you have like a dual hat going on here. So switch hats and then tell us who you are by day.
And in my other role, I'm also an associate director of philanthropy for United Way of Delaware.
And before we jump into the questions, I would be remiss if I did not have my partner in crime with the Winter Wonderland events come on and introduce herself.
Season's greetings, everyone. My name is Deborah Reeves. I'm the Senior Director for Engagement and Partnerships for United Way of Delaware.
Thank you. So our guest with the Lynx, can you share with our audience what inspired you to give and volunteer this year with the Winter Wonderland event?
Absolutely, sure. One of the things that I absolutely love about this event and about what United Way does in the community is we really want to make sure that we are creating authentic relationships and meeting people where the need is. And that is exactly what the Lynx do as well. We share the same vision and the same mission to make sure that we are meeting the needs of our neighbors in a way that's authentic and friendship driven. So that is one of the many reasons why we wanted to be involved. I think it's so important to be hands-on with your community members, with your neighbors, so that they know not only that you care, but they have a face to put with a name that they might see in the paper or might see in a magazine article. They know this is a real person, and this is a real person in your community that cares about you.
Thank you. Is there anything you wanted to add to that?
Well, I'll just say that this year we were really focused on voter education and registration and the importance of the upcoming elections in 2024, and just making sure that our community understands their right to vote, because every voice needs to be heard. And we want to make sure that everyone is registered so that they can let their voice be heard, especially in 2024.
Absolutely. Hear, hear.
That is so so important to make sure that individuals have the knowledge, mm-hmm. To be able to make an informed decision when it's time to, you know, go to those polls and make those decisions. So thank you for especially doing that. And then also thank you for just being on hand that day. I know there were several members of the Lynx who were able to come out in force and just be there to be on site to welcome all of the community members in. With a smiling face, and you guys were really hands-on to your point. We're just helping them to select a coat, a brand new coat, and a brand new toy for the holiday season. Could you tell us maybe just a little bit more of of what that experience was for you that day.
So I'll start off and
Please.
Let Chanel kind of echo. The one thing that we are excited about every year is making sure that we see that the needs are being met. It was incredibly heartwarming to see the faces of our children, of our youth, as they took off an old coat and put on a new one. Just the joy that that entire experience brought was so incredibly rewarding. And it re-emphasizes those things that are important to the Lynx Incorporated. It really is about meeting the needs of our community and really meeting them where they need it the most. And coats are so important. As we've seen, even with October, November, and December, this weather is up and down. And, you know, we really need to have that coverage. And so our children need to be covered. So it was incredibly heartwarming.
Absolutely. I mean, just seeing a child and their face light up when they find a coat that they love and they're taking off the old coat and throwing that coat away and putting on a new coat. It's probably one of the best feelings in the world to see their eyes light up. Also, it's a similar feeling when you see someone register to vote for the first time.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. They have questions and they have so much promise and possibility in that choice. I want to register to vote. I want my voice to be heard. And so it's just a blessing and an honor to be a part of that, to be someone that's there, hands-on, in front of that person while they have that experience. I don't think there's anything better than that, to be honest.
Thank you. Thank you both for sharing. I want to pivot a little bit and I want to transition to my colleague, Deborah, and just give us your interpretation of the day. And then also, could you share some of the impact numbers so our audience will know the impact that we had on that day?
Yeah, so so our goal was 1,000 coats and 1,000 toys for our kids in Delaware. So we were all over the state. We were in New Castle County, we were in Kent County, and we were in Sussex County. And I will tell you, as of right now, we hit our goal of over 1,000 coats. So awesome. Let's give a hand clap for that.
That's amazing.
We were just so super excited of everyone just came out and participated. And whether you gave up your time, your talent, or your treasure, we are so appreciative of the impact you've had on our community, because it's our community, right? When I think about Winter Wonderland, I think about what you just described, the young child taking off the old coat and putting on the new coat. You know, it's more than just a warm coat. It is putting just that hope. Right? That hope mm-hmm. for a better tomorrow. Yeah. Right? And that's what it's all about. It is the smiles. It is the thank yous. It is the hugs that we got that day.
Absolutely.
It was so much positive energy and so much love in that room. Mm-hmm. And you could feel it. I don't care what part of the room you were in, you could feel it everywhere. Yeah. We had haircuts happening. We had the young girls come down from Howard to do nails. We had Santa. We had so much going on. We had music, and it was just an event filled with love. And I think that inspired me, and I can't wait till next year.
Yeah, very excited.
Well, definitely thank you, everyone that is watching. You've heard what a great event that we had that was filled with so much love, inspiration, hope. And that's what this event was really about. It was about us showing up in force to provide hope and joy and season's greetings for our community members throughout the city of Delaware and throughout the city of Wilmington and throughout the state of Delaware. For me, I know it's always a feel-good event for me just to be able to see all the kids and the parents in the library with the ability to pick out their own coat and their own toy. Nothing was handed to them. Everyone was dealt with dignity. And we wanted individuals to feel like they matter at that event. And that's kind of like my why. My main purpose in life is really just to change one life. And I can only do that at one person, one child at a time. So for me, this event is always personal. It continues to grow. but we've had a lot of help. We've had a lot of sponsors, and I'm glad that the community came out and really enjoyed an overall event. Before we shift, do you have any last words or last comments?
Well, I'll just say that the day was electrifying. You said it best when you said that it's really just giving joy to one person at a time, one child at a time. That's what makes the difference, is really coming together as a community, letting them know that they matter.
Thank you.
And I would just like to thank United Way of Delaware. The work that went into this was substantial. And so I just want to give kudos and congratulations to the team that worked on Winter Wonderland for this year, because it was a bang out event. It was amazing. And I just can't wait to be a part of it again.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, audience, you heard it. Winter Wonderland was a smash hit. We have some other guests that we're going to bring on as well to kind of give their experience and talk a little bit more in depth about the event. So we're going to take a quick commercial break and be right back.
Got to pay back. Revenge.
Good evening and welcome back to Community Crossfire. Once again, I am your host, Ken Livingston, and joined today by my colleague, my co-host, Deborah Reeves. We were able to do some transitioning. We have two more special guests that we wanted to bring on today, just to once again talk about the overall impact of the Winter Wonderland at the Wilmington Library Coat and Toy event. So we're going to start off with the guests to my left.
So my name is Cassidy Ashworth. I'm a senior at Avengrove High School, and I've been volunteering for United Way for a few years now.
Thank you, Cassidy. And our next guest, Brother Craig.
Yes, hello, how you doing? My name is Craig Wolfrey. I'm the bossless president of the New Upsilon chapter of Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated.
Thank you. Thank you both for coming on. And I know, Cassidy, like you said, you've been volunteering for a number of years now with United Way of Delaware. I've been impressed with you since I've met you.
Oh, thank you.
Cassidy, every opportunity, every event that we've had, you've been able to support me in a number of different ways. And most especially by just using your network and just being you. I know over the years you've been able to support book drives, back to school drives, the coat and toy events, and just some other things that we've been able to collaborate on throughout your time with United Way of Delaware. And I just want to say thank you. You and your sisters and your mother, you're an amazing team. And once again, you've helped me so much to just be able to be at this point, at this level, at this space and time. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Brother Craig, man, the Omegas, y'all come every year. You show up, you show out. Y'all move with purpose and in excellence. I can't thank you guys enough as well. For just showing up and not just the numbers, but the support. Your presence at the events just makes everyone come in and they feel at ease. You know what I mean? I think you guys have really honed in on how to ensure that the building is safe. Individuals are coming in. We're moving in decency and in order. And just things are at a whole nother level when the brothers are there to really support the event. So I just wanted to say thank you to you personally, to you two personally, for those things. I'm going to jump into a question here. In your opinion, what role does volunteering play in building a stronger community? And Cassidy, we'll start with you.
So in a community, I think that volunteering is super important as it helps everyone know that they're not alone. So if they're struggling, you know, their neighbors are there for each other. And yeah, you'll just get help when needed and everyone's ready to jump in and just help.
Thank you. Thank you. Craig, talk to us about volunteering and just how does volunteering help to build stronger communities?
I think sometimes we have a tendency of seeing communities separate. There used to be a time where communities were a unit. And I think when you volunteer, you bring yourself back into the heart of what is going on around you. Sometimes you solve problems from a distance, but I think you have to be there and see the faces and see the people. And I think that when you volunteer, that's what you give. You're giving a part of yourself to the community so that they can see, hey, we're still all here. So I think that's always very important to always to do that, to volunteer and to put yourself out there for the community so the kids and people can see you.
Thank you. Thank you. In terms of volunteering, and this is a question for both of you, why United Way? Kind of twofold. Why United Way? And why the Winter Wonderland events?
Well, United Way has done a very good job of branching out not only with, you know, coats and toys, but also throughout schools in Delaware and providing books to kids that, you know, don't necessarily have books or at high reading levels. So United Way does a great job of getting themselves out there to where it's really needed. And for the coat drive, I think it's just a perfect opportunity to, you know, get coats out there to kids who, you know, need them. And yeah.
Good. Thank you. Thank you. Craig?
So we got introduced to the United Way through Carl Shaw at the library. Mm-hmm. It's the first time we met. It was 3 years ago, and it was at the Winter Wonderland event. And I was very impressed on the level of a commitment and love for the community that the United Way showed. And it aligned itself with how Omega sees itself. So we were like, we have to stay with this group. This is where it goes, because they're branching out. When we did the book bag drive and stuff like that, it was, I'm gonna find other ways to impact the community. So anytime you have people, especially days like times and now, where someone wants to impact their community, you wanna be a part of that. Now, why the Winter Wonderland event, it's an outstanding event. It's a great event. I have never seen so many kids smile. Some of these kids probably don't smile most of the time or don't always have as much fun as they do. When they come in there, they just go bananas. And I love it. You gotta love it. Mm-hmm. You know, you know they're there, the parents are smiling, and they're treated in a way that makes them feel appreciated. And mm-hmm. I think that was great. Especially if you said, watch them do, I wanted to get face painting, they didn't let me do it. But that's okay. You know, when they got the face painting and the nails done, and the kids just had a ball. And I think that for me was, and there was no problems at all. Mm-hmm. And I think that shows the greatness of the event.
Thank you, thank you. Deborah, I want to kind of lean into you during this time, because I know we at United Way, we just don't do kind of like Winter Wonderland, but we do a number of things in the community. And I want to give you the opportunity to say or let the audience know, if they want to volunteer with United Way of Delaware, how can they go about contacting someone to find out how they can register to sign up to become a volunteer?
Thank you for asking. So if anyone wants to vote, we have all kinds of volunteer events available, not just Winter Wonderland, but other events. And so if you are interested in volunteering, I'm going to need you to get your pen out. dreeves@uwde.org, or you can go on the United Way website under You Volunteer, and you can sign up. There's a plethora of events that are on the website. That will suit whether you want to do reading, whether you want to participate in Winter Wonderland, whether you want to participate in the book bag drive or other things, all listed on the website. One of the events that we have coming up in January is our poverty simulation. And that is a simulation that you participate in, and you take on the role of people that are struggling, and you go through it and you become that family. And it's a way to show empathy. And it's one of my favorite events because when we go through the debrief, people talk about the impact that it has on them, or the impact that it had on them, or the fact that they were once walking in those shoes and once they lived in poverty. And so we're doing that on January 12th. It's going to be at the Goodwill Industries, 300 Leah Boulevard. Again, if you're interested in signing up your teams, your family, or you as an individual, please, again, reach out to me, dreeves@uwde.org, or go on our website, and it's under You Volunteer. Thanks.
Thank you, Deborah. And before we close out our segment, I just want to give our guests an opportunity just to tell us about a favorite highlight moment at the event that took place at the Wilmington Library on December 16th with our third annual Winter Wonderland. And we're gonna go around, so be thinking of your answers, and then I'll finish up with mine. But Cassidy, just give us a highlight of the event moment that you had.
So at Winter Wonderland, my sisters and I were in charge of passing out the toys and helping each kid pick out which toy they would want. And it was so awesome to see all the kids. They would get their new coat, put on their new coat, and run over to the toys. And, you know, their eyes would light up, their face would light up, and they were just so excited to pick out a toy for themselves. And then in the beginning of Winter Wonderland, they were also able to pick out books while the supplies lasted. And the amount of kids that were so happy to get a book was just so amazing to see.
Thank you. Thank you. Craig?
Well, I had a couple moments that I thought that were great. I got to kind of reflect back to when it first started, and we're in the one small room, and it was people came through. Mm-hmm. But when you walk out and you saw the crowd, or I didn't even see it went around the block. All I could see is it kept on going.
Right.
But when the kid, when they started coming in, it wasn't like somebody was standing in line. Like, you know, sometimes you have a feeling of anxiousness. It was like sheer excitement when they blew through. And they had a good time. They got their face painted. Like I said, the face painting. I think for me, that was like one of my favorite things, because the kids are just sitting there and they just can't wait. They're just hopping and they can't wait to do the next thing. Mm-hmm. All the gentlemen that were going to get their haircuts and their nails getting done. I think it was just well thought out, and I think that was just a great event. I don't know why I keep smiling. I feel like, you know, but that I think was probably one of my favorite things.
Good. Thank you. Deborah?
Oh, wow, it's just so much. I say my favorite thing was just the impact that the volunteers, our sponsors, the community, you all sitting here with us today, just gave of their time, their talent, their treasure, the smiles, the positivity in that room. And I tell you, those kids were so tickled to put on those coats and get their toy. That just touches you. My other favorite thing is that part of this volunteer corps is my 19-year-old daughter. And she would not stop talking about this all the way home. And so the impact is not just on the kids that are getting the coats. The impact extends longer to the volunteers and everyone that helps. If anyone, we're doing this next year, everyone. So be on the lookout for our emails and for our flyers. And we'd like you all to come out and participate with us. It is a worthwhile event, and you are having a positive impact on our kids. They are not our future. They are our right now. So come on out and help.
Thank you. And I guess for me, as we close, it's for me, it was the partnerships and the collaborations. We don't often do anything good by ourselves. It's a team behind us. I know myself and Deb might have been the primary contacts, but as you see today, we had people who were involved with us, who were in the fight with us, who continue to be in the trenches to ensure that communities, parents, children, they have what they need. And that's what that really event was really all about, just making sure that individuals had what they needed. In addition to the coats and toys, we had some of our partners were able to set up community resource tables. So we had resources there. And the one thing, the icing on the cake for me, was having Best Kept Soul there to sing holiday classics and some R&B favorites. So as parents were there in line and as students were excited to go grab toys, you could see everyone just in the library just swaying back and forth, listening to Best Kept Soul. And that just eased all the angst or all the tension that anyone might have had while you were waiting in line. And I just want to thank everyone that came out who did stand in line prior to coming into the library. Thank you for your patience. It's a lot of work that goes into it. We want to make sure that everything that we do is in decency and order. So all the participants that came out, the families, the parents, the children, the community members, our sponsors, our organizations, it's probably too many to name. Charge it to my heart and not my head. But I just want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart to everyone that was involved with our 2023 third annual Winter Wonderland Coat and Toy Distribution event at the Wilmington Library. I want to say thank you on behalf of our CEO and United Way President, Dr. Michelle Taylor, myself, Ken Livingston, Deborah Reeves, our team at United Way, and once again, our number of hosts, colleagues, sponsors, organizations. Once again, just thank you, thank you, thank you. As we close this segment of Community Crossfire, we want to say happy holidays to everyone. Continue to be safe, and happy new year.
Got to pay back. Revenge.
Today we gather here, 24th and Market, where our community is saturated by violence, by overdose, by this fentanyl. We're here giving out Narcan, engaging our community, and it's necessary that we're here. You know, sometimes we come, we drive through, we wave, but to get out and to engage in our community in meaningful ways, it's purposeful, it's with love, and we're out here because we know there's a need to be out here addressing this fentanyl, this opioid, this trank, and all other drugs that causes great destruction to our community.
Well, good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for Community Crossfire. I want to thank Stormer Norman Oliver and Councilwoman Xanthia Oliver for giving us the opportunity to come and host their show. I appreciate you, and we send out holiday greetings to both of you. I have in the room with me my guest for the afternoon, Dr. Shelleryn Addison, and we're so delighted that she has come to share with us, and we're going to allow her to introduce herself in a minute. But we want to kind of delve into where we are and kind of the current and the climate of our community. I think 9/11 and COVID has kind of put us in a very precarious position, to say the least. The pandemic have thrusted us into an epidemic that we find ourselves with the covers and the comforters literally pulled off of us, and all of a sudden this great wave of mental illness now has hit our community and our churches. And one of the problems that I saw in regards to being the president of IMAC is that we were not given any tools in our tool chest for this particular pandemic. We were not able to find ways by which we would properly minister to our people and keep the connection of communication with our parsons and with our parishioners. And so
we put into place in our IMAC committee organization a faith and mental health component. And we gave it to this wonderful woman that I love, named Dr. Shelleryn Addison. I'm going to let her introduce herself because I would not do her justice. Much learning has made her mad. And she has so many degrees and so many positions and titles. I'm going to let her introduce herself and just talk to us a little bit about kind of where we are and why faith and mental illness.
Well, bless you, Bishop. Thank you for having me. You are our fearless leader for IMAC. I'm Reverend Dr. Shelleryn Addison in the civilian world, Chaplain Major Shelleryn Addison in the Army world. I am the first woman to serve as chaplain in the history of the Delaware Army National Guard. Faith and grief and mental health are right in my wheelhouse. That's what I do with my soldiers. When I'm not in uniform, I'm a hospice chaplain. And so we do a lot of work around faith and grief. The challenge that I've found over the years, I've been a hospice chaplain for 15 years, is that people of faith know that God is with them, but don't give God permission to be with them when they need to be. So we talk about some glad morning when this life is over. We talk about to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. However, to talk about it and then to actually have to live it are two different spaces. And I find that people of faith don't give themselves permission not to be okay. So COVID unleashed this not okay. And it collides with their faith. Trauma has now destroyed what they thought was going to happen. And heaven forbid, you couldn't go to the church and you couldn't touch the pastor and you had to get a prayer through on your own. So we have what I call created some bipolar Christians. Mm-hmm. In the sense that we told them to trust God, but we didn't give them the toolkit to actually do it. So we have a lot of people walking on the surface of their faith, and now mental illness has said, oh, no, 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 no. You got to really talk it and walk it. Your audio has to line up with your visual. So IMAC is determined to give the toolkit to these communities of faith in our partnership with Telehealth 24/7.
Well, listen, I am so appreciative to your passion and your commitment. You have given us as cleric and me especially the permission to say it's okay not to be okay.
Amen.
And so I so appreciate that. I was concerned because you and I shared at the same seminary at Lutheran Theological Seminary, but nothing at Lutheran prepared us to how to minister in a pandemic and then how to handle this trauma. Like there was nothing connected, you know, to our academia and our matriculation that gave us the ability. And then all of a sudden, when the pandemic hit, our congregants were pulling at us to get from us help with mental illness, and we did not have the tools. We did not have the ability. Nothing in academia spoke to that. And I said to our clergy at IMAC that when I grew up, you know, it was spit, oil, you know, lay on hand, come out, you know, bind the devil, go back to the pit from where you came. And right now we need a couch and a pill.
Amen,
you know?
Amen.
And so why don't you talk to me a little bit about your passion about mental illness and how you are directing us along with Tell Up 24/7. Hopefully Robert Adams will get here, that we could talk more about how we put those two communities together so we could find wholeness and care for our people.
Absolutely. Well, it starts with the head. It starts with leadership. It starts with leadership understanding that you can't help anybody else breathe if you can't breathe. When you get on the airplane, they tell you to put your mask on first. They tell you that because as much as you want to help somebody else, you can't if you're dying. And so for faith leaders, first we got to get them to a position where they can say self-care is important. Mm-hmm. It's okay to talk to the doctor. It's okay. It doesn't mean you don't have faith. You can have faith and not be okay. You know, because if you're having a heart attack and they say take that pill, you might dip it in some anointing oil, but you're still going to take that pill. They say you have cancer, then you're going to take that chemo. But when it comes to mental health, we align it with demons. We align it with what you said, slap some oil on it, roll on the floor. We don't align it with serious medical intervention. And so part of the challenge that we found is just reducing the stigma and the shame. It's not just the stigma of I'm not okay. It's the shame of saying I'm not okay.
Yeah.
And in the faith community, that is an absolute no-no. And so breaking the barrier of saying that God's big enough to handle my anxiety, that takes a lot. So in IMAC, I start with the leaders and say, it's okay not to be okay. Yeah. And once they begin to preach it and teach it and integrate it into the life of the community of faith, things begin to change. People just need a safe space to say, I'm not okay.
I think one of the things, Shelley, that you and I have talked about is my concern that often the preacher will not disseminate the information to his community of faith so that what he hears is the same thing that they hear also, so that they know there's help available and people that are available. I want to talk about this gigantic word called trauma for a minute because I think one of the things that we fail to realize is oftentimes our community lives in an environment of trauma.
Absolutely.
And if you will, just kind of speak to that whole trauma thing and how frightening it is kind of for us kind of to embrace and engage in.
Yeah. Absolutely. We all grew up in a time where what happens in this house stays in this house.
Yes.
And that's embedded in the fabric of who we are. Mm-hmm. So coming outside of that to say that trauma is real makes you have to say what happens in this house can't stay in this house.
Wow.
And people have lived many, many years with molestation and drug abuse and alcoholism and all kinds of things. But they keep it together. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like Humpty Dumpty sat on the wall. Humpty Dumpty had a great fall. Mm-hmm. Most people don't want to fall apart because they don't know if they can be put back together again.
Wow.
And the tragedy of it is that healing only happens when you open your mouth and say something. You know, there's a saying that says a baby won't get fed unless they open their mouth and say anything. Mm-hmm. But that safe space of knowing that what you're saying will be kept in confidence, that's another challenge. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to say something that's hard for faith leaders to understand, but we want people to be dependent. Part of being a faith leader is that point of they're depending on you as the leader. And so how do you empower them but also stay the leader? And so therein lies the fine line for many faith communities. They're like, if I give them all the information, they won't need me.
Yeah, and I think that part of the problem is our need to be needed.
Our need to be needed.
and that people actually can kind of navigate on their own if we gave them the tools.
Absolutely.
You know, as that old little parable about, you know, that I went to the fisherman, you know, so he could go fishing for me, but he decided to teach me how to fish so I could fish for myself.
Absolutely.
And sometimes we don't want to put those kind of tools in people's hands so they could do it for themselves. But I think that is the maturity of leadership.
It is.
That I in turn empower you. I teach my leaders is that you always should be working your way out of a position.
Absolutely.
And then copying yourself in somebody that if by chance something happens to you, we don't lose.
Right.
We have somebody that's efficient, that's effective, that's able to carry on that particular duty and that particular activity. I get concerned about this need to be needed. I'm working on that for people because.
Well, you know, trauma is invasive.
Okay, that's what it is.
You know,
okay.
Trauma,
okay.
It's so scary because sometimes you just don't know the boundaries of it, right? You one thing can trigger you, and it can open up so many more things. The brain is so amazing in that we compartmentalize memories, so that we don't have to remember them anymore. And then one thing can trigger one thing, which triggers one thing. And this whole time you've had it locked away, safe, to protect yourself. So it's just a protective measure. But sometimes trauma could be so overwhelming that people just don't want to touch it.
Yeah.
And as a pastor, as a leader, you have to touch your trauma if you're helping somebody else with their trauma.
Yeah.
So as long as I can be distracted, you could be busy doing the work of the church that you're not being the church.
Yeah, because we get so busy that we're too busy.
Right.
And we're spinning wheels and really not going anywhere.
Absolutely.
Maxwell says no one ever drowns from falling in the water. They drown when they stay in.
That's right.
That the statistics of drowning is that the people that usually drown, they drown in shallow water, that they have expended all their energy, mm-hmm. tussling and swimming and crawling and scratching to get to shore, that by the time they get to shore, all they would have to do is stand up.
But isn't that a sermon in itself?
Yeah, but they've been fighting so hard yes. that they drown in shallow water. They don't know to stand up. And I think that what we have to do is constantly rehearse in the hearts and the heads of people, it's time to stand up.
It's time.
We're going to take a break here and come back. But this has been exciting. I'm looking forward to the second half of our conversation. You've been here with us with Dr. George E. Gibson II and Dr. Shelarina Addison in Community Crossfire. Thank you for sharing with us this afternoon.
Got to pay back. Revenge.
Good day to you, and hello again, and thank you for joining us for the second half of Community Crossfire. I'm here in the room with my good friend and colleague, Dr. Shelarina Addison, and we're so delighted to be with you on this afternoon. IMAC has received from the governor, and we're so delighted that we are the trauma-informed religious organization, the number one in the state. And we received a wonderful award from the governor. I want to thank Governor John Carney for acknowledging us and recognizing our work. Along with that, we have collaborated and joined forces with our Lieutenant Governor, Bethany Hall Long, and she has been able to get opioid funds into the state by which IMAC has been one of the recipients. And Dr. Shelarina Addison is going to share with us our fight in the place and the space of the opioid epidemic. And also we'll talk to you a little about what's coming up on this Saturday as we share in our first community outreach in the pre-screening of The Color Purple. It's in your hands, Dr. Addison. You got
all
a lot
right,
to say.
All right. You know, it's important for us to be trauma-informed. Mm-hmm. It's important for us to be trauma-informed because we are the voice mm-hmm. of the faith leaders. And if we don't set a precedence that we have to integrate trauma-informed care, counseling, language, it has to be in there because everyone in our pews is affected by trauma. Mm-hmm. The leader is affected by trauma. And so it's an honor for us to serve as the subject matter experts of mm-hmm. what happens when trauma collides with our faith. And so one of the things we've done with that is also understanding that the opioid epidemic is affecting the faith community. Mm-hmm. And we can't just sit in the pew and watch what everybody else is doing. We have to be educated and be able to speak to what's happening in our society and in our congregations. So we've partnered with Lieutenant Governor to really get the word out there mm-hmm. for faith communities to understand that We have opioid-addicted folk in our pews. And wow. If we don't have the language, if we don't have the toolkit, if we don't have the resources to help them, then we're talking brass and sounding cymbals. Mm. And they'll come and they'll come and they'll still be addicted and it'll still be an epidemic. And we have to be in the fight, equipped and ready to jump in. And so we have been creative in our effort to spread the word about the opioid epidemic. And so Saturday, we're doing a pre-screening of Color Purple. We're bringing in all the faith leaders, not all of them. The theater's not that big, but the ones who have agreed to come. And we're going to talk about what are we doing in our pews. We've got to get beyond the walls. We've got to get beyond just talk about it, pray about it. They need some Narcan. They need a training facility. They need to go to rehab. And the pastor can't just say, pray about it and go home.
Yeah, I am excited about the Color Purple. Everyone is just so revved up and energized.
Yes.
Now you got to come. Those that you know that are on our RSVP list and our VIP list, make sure you have your finest purple on.
Yes.
And come on and share as we participate in getting the word out to community. I remember, Shelley, you and I having the conversation. One of the things of the books that you and I are working on is that we have to make sure that we kind of leave our gift at the altar and go back and find ourselves.
Yes.
And that whole idea of making sure that we're not praying over our pain and worshiping, you know, while we're wounded and that wound not being attended to. And, you know, kind of preaching, you know, through our pain and all those things. I was listening to Dr. E. Dewey Smith. He was talking about the loss of his mother. And he said if he would have broke his arm or broke his back or something, he would not have come to church or preached through that kind of trauma.
Mm-hmm.
And the trauma of his mother had wore him down so low, but he still came and preached, and he had to realize how traumatized
Absolutely.
He was. And he said, and so I should have stayed away.
Should've.
And then he said, like 5 months later, he actually started getting help. Mm. And it processed. But when I heard him say that, I said to myself, I said, you know, people go through what they go through, and they so easily move themselves away, or walk away, or step away,
mm-hmm.
or leave their post of duty. But they think that the man of God or the woman of God, the preacher, the pastor, the parson, supposed to be able to handle it because you got another level of God that they don't
exactly.
And so exactly. I think sometimes we forget that it's not necessary to wear the S on our chest.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, so talk a little bit about that. Yeah.
You know, that's not something we learned in seminary either.
Okay, there you go.
We didn't learn about that S on our chest in seminary. What we did learn was to be emotionally distant from what we're doing. Like, right. I'm a hospice chaplain. So as a doctor, as a clinician, you have professional distance that you put between you and the patient.
Mm-hmm.
And so as a pastor, we have this emotional, this spiritual distance that we put in between us and the parishioners that we become superhuman almost, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And so we don't have the ability to come down to their level. So people say, I put my pants on the same way, but how people see us mm-hmm. is just different.
Yeah.
Now, we're not saying that that's our intention to be superhuman, but because of the nature of faith, mm-hmm. whoever that leader is becomes superhuman.
Yeah.
And so what's important is to have a peer group of mm-hmm. superhuman preachers who can then find a safe space together.
Yeah.
So for IMAC, that's one of the things we're doing. So we're going to do the pilot program at Love Nation,
yes.
where we're going to do a group just for faith leaders mm-hmm. in a safe space that we can talk about trauma, we can talk about self-care, we can talk about it's okay not to be okay.
Yeah.
Healing starts from the head. Aaron's beard, it comes down.
Yeah, it's amazing to me that you constantly have been talking to us about self-care. I know many of my colleagues, and I was talking to somebody today, they just won't go to the doctor.
Mm-hmm.
They just won't go to the doctor. So I would listen to one of my friends saying, this 47-year-old guy had a stroke.
Mm.
This 55-year-old guy had a heart attack. And I'm saying to myself, what is going on? And they just wouldn't go to the doctor. The one guy that had the stroke, they found out that he had diabetes, but wouldn't tell nobody. But when they went back to check his truck, because he couldn't drive, he's in the hospital, in a coma, his diabetes medicine all in the truck. But he didn't tell nobody. And so part of it is being able to share with the people that you care about and care about you, and realizing that you need to go to find out what's going on with you, so you can have a barometer.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so you can have something to measure by. And I think that the self-care that you constantly talk to us about, you know, even with us working with Dr. Garcia and the endovascular,
absolutely,
our community of faith, is high blood pressure, sugar diabetes, high cholesterol, heart disease. All of that is the stuff that now works towards poor circulation. And then we didn't know until working with Dr. Garcia that Delaware is the number one amputee state.
Isn't well, that now something?
That's now if that's not trauma.
If that's not trauma.
You know, so what happens is that I think that we have to just push the envelope forward to make sure that our people are getting, you know, screenings and assessments so that they can be the better and we can help them be the better. I think we have to make sure, for me, you know, I tell people all the time, we belong to a larger organization. You got to make sure you disseminate the information to your people, because the people need to know where the resources are.
Absolutely. That brings me to your newest book, Bishop, where you're talking to men about trauma.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? Because you think about what you said. They won't go to the doctor. A woman will readily go to the doctor. Mm-hmm. But there's something about a man, y'all, if it ain't broke, y'all still going to work. That, and that's it.
Yeah.
If your leg's still working, y'all still working. Right? And so to speak to men about it's okay not to be okay. Yeah. It's going to be something that's going to be vital to the men of faith.
Yeah,
and I'm excited about that.
I'm excited about that too, because, and I appreciate, you know, you pushing me, because these things I see and I talk about in other circles, but I need to constantly talk them to in our particular intimate circles, because we just need help. And that whole facade of being, you know, the star and the prima donna, you don't need that anymore.
Yeah.
Just be who you are and help those that need the help, but make sure, as you say, that you're helping yourself along the way so you can live a long time.
Right.
And live a healthy life. I think that one of the things, watch this, that we haven't been talking about, and Dr. Williams was talking to me about it when we was at our Christmas brunch. He was talking about sometimes we just don't know when to step away. So what kind of succession plan are we putting in place to step away to make sure that who we bring in place will be respected, will be honored, will be reverenced and taken care of, but also in a position to take care of the church.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So we're in a grooming season.
Yeah.
A grooming season where we're teaching this younger generation that it's okay not to be okay. The flip side of that is that they don't have the same bounce back. The resilience to be able to do what we do. You know, you think about, I was listening to the radio and they were saying that school needs to start at 8:30 because kids don't want to wake up in the morning. And I'm thinking, what happened to the kids? What happened to the kids that they can't wake up and go to school? And now we're going to rearrange the whole day.
The whole day.
So that they don't have to go to school. And then what they going to do? Not until noon. They can't wake up.
Yeah.
But you put some candy or you put some Rachel or something on, they up at 7.
Yeah, it's
and
it's
so we coddle them in some sense.
Yeah. I think that's part of the problem, that we don't give them the accountability and the responsibility that we had. And for me, this whole idea that what has been for the longest time normal for us is now abnormal.
It is.
That everything, you know, like, you know, so now you're doing wonderful when you're not smart. so you're dumb, you're the bomb, you know what I mean? So I'm not, I get confused. We running out of time. Let me share a few things. A LEAP, which is the Labor, Economics, Education, and Empowerment. invite you to Pathway to Apprenticeship, a 6-week construction trade career pathway program. Upon completion, opportunity to earn $1,500 a week includes training, tools, boots, career, Twic card, and weekly stipend. Next class is January the 15th, 2024, and the location is 101 Rogers Road, Suite 102. Actually having an information session tomorrow, Friday the 22nd, at 12 p.m. and 6 p.m. So that's 12 noon and 6 p.m. And next Friday the 29th at 12 noon and 6 p.m. So come be a part of our LEAP headquarters and find yourself a new career, a new place to make a livable wage and live healthy. Keep your ears open on the 14th of January, 2024. The Martin Luther King service held by IMAC will be at the New Destiny Church, where Apostle Thomas Wesley Weeks is the pastor. We'll be sharing there. Dr. John Gunn from Jacksonville, Florida, will be our preacher, the pastor of the St. Paul Baptist Church in Jacksonville, and the president of Virginia Union Theological Seminary in Richmond, Virginia. A phenomenal preacher. Phenomenal preacher. You want to come and hear him. Also, Zach Williams and One Accord from Philadelphia, recording artist choir, will be our guests on that night. We're going to have a phenomenal time. We want you to come and be a part of that. Look at it, we love you. We're out of time. We're not out of information because we got information and inspiration for you, but we're out of time. Community Crossfire, thank you again, Storm and Norman. Thank you, Councilwoman Xanthia Oliver, for allowing us to be here to host this segment of Community Crossfire. Celebrine, thank you. Love you. Say goodbye to the people.
All right. It's been my pleasure. It's my honor to serve. We're going to see you out in these streets.
Out in these streets. Happy holidays to you all. Thank you.
Revenge. I'm mad. About to get back. I need some gift.